This is Isabel Warah bringing you greetings from Kabod Outreach, and you are all welcome to this part of the broadcast where we will be discussing about the empowerment of the Holy Spirit in the life of a Christian. And I want to welcome my brother evangelist Peter Njua from Louisiana, who will be a part of this discussion, and he will be shedding a lot of light based on his experience with the Holy Spirit in his walk of faith. So Kabod Outreach is a platform where we gather under the weight of God's presence and we live with the upper room experience, equipped for great exploits to take the good news to the ends of the earth, from our communities all the way to the ends of the earth. So when we get together, we know that the Holy Spirit is there to lead us, and He meets you at every point of your need. He ministers to you as an individual. That is why we had the promise of the Holy Spirit. We are all evangelists, winning souls for the kingdom. So that is why we have our brother here, Brother Peter, and we will be basing today's discussion on how the Holy Spirit empowers us to be able to carry on with the work of God. I am so excited to introduce to you my beloved brother evangelist Peter Ngonine from Louisiana. So Brother Peter Ngonine, evangelist, you are so welcome to Kabod Outreach. So what is the revelation that you have for us? Let us know, first of all, who we have in the house.
Thank you so much, my sister, Mr. Isabel. I'm so happy, you know, to be on this program today. Yes, as you rightly say, my name is Evangelist Peter. I'm based here in Bossier City in Louisiana. And actually run this ministry. It's an online ministry, prayer ministry, and evangelistic ministry, where we pray and we sponsor the gospel evangelism around the world, because we know that is God's heartbeat. And I would just like to quickly say something. You know, I know a lot of people be asking, why a prayer slash evangelistic ministry? You know, evangelism is actually stepping in the devil's territory to liberate the people of God, to set the captives free. And the Bible rightly says, you can't step into a strong man's house and plunder his goods without first of all binding him. So prayer helps to clear the atmosphere so that evangelism can be effective and powerful. So that is why, you know, I'm running this ministry. The prayer is a lifeline prayer ministry slash evangelistic ministry. So I'm so happy to be here today, as I said, and I know God has some great things for us today in store. Thank you so much, woman of God.
Oh, you're very welcome, my brother. And I do know also that you do fellowship with a church in Louisiana, where you are the head of their prayer ministry. So can you tell us a bit about that as well?
Okay, yeah. So when I moved here to Louisiana in 2015, I was asking God, you know, why He actually sent me here. Because before leaving Maryland to Louisiana, I believe God actually sent me here, and He sent me here for a purpose. So I was trusting God to show me, to direct me to the ministry He wants me to serve, because I know I've been called to be an encouragement to the body of Christ. And so I later on came across this great ministry. I mean, it's a long story. I don't think we'll have time today for me to go into the details, but I just want to say God actually led me to this ministry, and I became a part of it. And immediately I came to this ministry, the pastor, after he had known me, he said something that really kind of like really caught my attention. He said, before I came, the church was praying and asking God for an evangelist. And 2 weeks later, I showed up. So I believe that God sent me to a people that were already prepared and ready for my coming.
Amen.
And He knew what He was to do through me in this ministry. And so when I came, the pastor handed the prayer ministry of the church to me. You know, at first when he wanted me to lead the prayer ministry, I was like, pastor, can you just, you know, let me pray about it. But he was, you know, people were kind of like, where did you ever know this guy? So he told them that I don't know him in person, but I know the spirit that lives in him. So that's how I became the director or the coordinator of the prayer ministry in this church. And I also go to other churches around preaching every month. Like there's a church in Texas where I go there once every month, you know, to preach, encourage the people to do the things God have called them to do. So that's how I actually came to be a part of this great ministry called Life Church. It's an Assemblies of God ministry.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Yeah, before we even move into the topic of discussion today, I really just want to give you this word of encouragement that your work, your labor will never go in vain. The reality is you are not only waiting for the life after to be blessed. God is blessing you right here because he has opened the eyes of people to see what you are doing, and then he takes the glory. That is how we got connected, because I could feel the spirit. I know that you are a man who is selfless, your family, and God blessed you with such a wonderful wife, Sister Blending, who is such a gracious woman too, and she has been of great support to you. So I just pray that his abundance will never leave your house, and that he will encourage you as you continue to encourage the body of Christ. So my brother, you know, from the book of Acts chapter 1 verse 8, Jesus was encouraging his disciples, and he asked them that they will wait and then they will receive power after they have received the infilling of the Holy Spirit. And, you know, I believe this promise was because he knew that the work that was ahead of them, they could only be activated or empowered to do it by the power of the Holy Spirit. And this promise goes to all of us believers today. For us to live an effective life as a believer, we need the Holy Spirit. So based on your personal experience, I just wanted you to shed a bit of light on your walk of faith and the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. So can you just testify to us about how the Holy Spirit has led you through this walk, as you're telling us and encouraging us? We know there are people who want to serve God, but they are having difficulties. So I just want you to, you know, help us by telling us about your experience with the Holy Spirit and how he is facilitating your walk of faith.
Thank you. Before I go ahead, you know, one thing, when Jesus in John chapter 14, verse 21, before his crucifixion, he had promised his disciples that they will receive, he will send the helper. So I want us to understand the Holy Spirit is called the helper. And if Amen. You have someone as a helper, it means that some things you're limited in doing and you need the help, you need the assistance of that person. So the Holy Spirit is a person. So when Jesus was saying in Acts 1:8, he said, you shall receive power after the Holy Spirit has come upon you. After he had promised them to send them the helper in John 14:26. That is to tell us that we can't do effective ministry without the help of the Holy Spirit. And I want to just testify in my life. You know, when I surrendered to Jesus, I used to be this guy. I was a very religious person. I believed in God. I knew there was a God. I knew there was heaven and hell. And at times I would even talk to people. But, you know, I've not really yielded my life to the Holy Spirit. And when I surrendered to Jesus and I was empowered by the Holy Spirit, I became a different person. I became bold. I became courageous to preach the word of God and to live the life God wants me to live. I'm not saying that I'm all perfect, but I'm saying that the Holy Spirit has helped me in my walk with God overcome Amen. Weaknesses that I had in my life that Amen. I could never overcome yes. by myself. If you're a child of God out there and you're wondering, you're like, this Christian life is so difficult, as I've heard many Christians at times mm-hmm. confess, they say the Christian life is so challenging, so tough. It's challenging when you want to do it by yourself and on your own. But if you depend on the helper, the Holy Spirit, he will help you, and the Christian life will become a life of fun, because Very the true. Holy Spirit will carry that heavy load that you can't carry on your own, and it will make you feel happy, peaceful, courageous, bold, empowered to do that which the Father has called you to do. So that is how the Holy Spirit has been helping me, and I know he's able to help somebody watching today.
Oh, great, great, great. And I thank God your mother named you well, Peter. Because if you look at the life of Peter, you know, before he received the Holy Spirit, he was a timid person. That's why he denied Jesus. You remember in Acts chapter 2, when Peter received the Holy Spirit, after he received the Holy Spirit, he testified. And then many people received the Holy Spirit. But if you look at him before then, he was a timid person. While they were taking Jesus to be crucified, you know, Peter denied Jesus. He said he did not know Jesus. Just by a little girl, you know, saying that this man was one of the followers of Jesus. Peter swore that he never knew Jesus. I don't think he was doing that out of his will, because previously he had told Jesus that he would never deny Jesus, that he will follow him no matter what. But then you see that when he was confronted by pressure, he denied Jesus. So let's go back to Acts chapter 2. You see the great manifestation of his testimony, when he testified of Christ and these people gave their lives and received the Holy Spirit with evidence. So I believe that's the same thing you're talking about, you know, the empowerment of the Holy Spirit and you being able to be bold to minister now. So I know the Word of God tells us that he has not given us a spirit of timidity, but he has given us a spirit of boldness and a sound mind. So can you just expand on that word a bit?
Thank you. Like as I was saying earlier, you know, a lot of people today, the thing they can do, they can actually do this on their own. Like you rightly said about Peter. Peter was a timid man before, you know, the Holy Spirit came in the book of Acts. Peter had said to himself, or told Jesus, he said, "I will never deny you. I will die with you." I know that a lot of Christians at times, they will tell themselves, "I can do this." You know, I've heard a lot of people say, "Trust me, I can do this." Yeah, there are things you cannot do without the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit, when you yield to the Holy Spirit comes, he emboldens you, he empowers you, he makes you to be courageous, to live for Jesus. We have a lot of timid and shy Christians today. You know, just like the Bible says in Romans 1:16, where Paul was saying, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel, mm-hmm. it is the power of God." Mm-hmm. So yes. I want us to understand that the Holy Spirit has been given to us to preach this gospel with boldness, with sound mind. And as you begin to yield and open up to him, he is going to do just that. Amen.
Okay. Amen. Amen. We know the word of God in Jeremiah 23:29 says God's word is fire. It's like fire and it's like a hammer that can break even a rock. So from what you are saying, if we believe in his word and we apply his word, I believe we will have that power and we will, you know, we will see ourselves overcoming that spirit of timidity, because whatever he says, that is what it is. He is a great God and he is the same forever. His word stands. All we have to do is apply it. So thank you so much for that testimony, our brother Peter. I think of myself and I remember when I gave my life to Christ, how I used to struggle on my own to do a whole lot, but I realized I kept failing in all my ways. I knew exactly what I wanted. I knew that I desired God. I desired to please him. But every time I struggled, I just found myself not being able to do it. And even till this day, anything I try to do in my own effort doesn't go right. But I thank God for the power of the Holy Spirit. That's why I think, as you know, people of God or Christians, followers of Christ, we have to be conscious of the presence of the Holy Spirit so that we can face whatever situation we are facing in life. And I thank you so much, because I believe this is going out to encourage a lot of us who are viewers, who are watching, to remember to invite the Holy Spirit to help us in our walk with Christ. We cannot do it on our own. There is just no way we can do it on our own. And I cannot go out there and be telling lies to people by encouraging you or motivating you by thinking thinking to yourself that it is by your strength or your intellect or whatever that you can carry on and successfully do the work of God. No, we can only do it by the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. Because if we look at what happened to King Saul, he had studied the ways of God when Samuel was ministering. He saw it, and at a given point, he thought he has known so much that he walked ahead of the Spirit of God, and he decided to carry out this sacrifice without obedience. It wasn't something for him to do. So even as children of God, we have to be very careful. We have to be spirit-led in our ways, because we don't have to get familiar with the things of God and then we just think we can go out and do it because we are used to it, or we know it, or we know how God works. I just pray that we'll humble ourselves to the Holy Spirit and always move with Him and let Him help us. So that being said, Brother Peter, my dear evangelist, you know, you are my brother first before being an evangelist. So,
yes.
We are family, and I am so grateful for that. There is just no other way I am even thinking of calling you another name, because it feels like I'm separating myself from you. No, I thank God we are parts of the same body. So we praise God for that. So, my brother, thank you so much for this encouragement. And I believe as we are doing what we are doing or talking, the Holy Spirit is ministering, and somebody is being encouraged, somebody is being directed now, the heart of someone is being touched, because I know a lot of people are struggling with a lot of things, and some people don't really want to submit because they are afraid of the unknown. But I will tell you that there is nothing that will ever challenge the Word of God. There is nothing that will ever challenge the power of God, because we weren't born in church. We have known the ways of the world, and you can only confront that and overcome by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So I am glad for this time that we are sharing. I'm so excited because in my spirit, I feel like somebody is receiving something new, that probably they have been in an environment that is a Christian environment for so long, but they never had this experience because they never had the understanding of what they needed. And they've been trying in their own power. They've been trying in their own ways. They've been trying thinking they can touch God's grace. But then I believe we just need to surrender, open our hearts. So I remember you mentioned something about, total surrender earlier when we were talking. So can you just, talk about what a Christian or how a Christian supposed to present their hearts to God so that He can use them, present a pliable heart that the Holy Spirit can work with? Can you just bring us something on that?
Amen. I want to first of all say this. You know, the world has this notion and this saying that they say, fake it until you make it. And I see this saying gradually creeping into the church, where a lot of people are faking it in order to make it, and they end up with a lot of disappointments and heartbreaks. But I want to say here, if we really want to see God use us, we need to totally surrender to Him. We need to be very sincere to God and to ourselves. You know, at times a lot of people come to God and they will not be truthful even to God. You know, God knows our hearts, and He knows the intention of our hearts. That's why the Bible says, Jesus said somewhere to His disciples, He says, it's not what goes in the man that defiles the man, it's what comes out of the heart. So your heart is like the engine of your life. It's like if you're driving a car that has a problem with the engine, that car will stop with you somewhere. You might be going, you might be embarking on a journey, and somewhere along the way, you'll be, that car will just stop on the way because you didn't take time to check the engine. So it's the same with our heart. We have to be very sincere when we come to God. Let's tell God exactly where the problem is. Because as I said, the Holy Spirit wants to walk with us. He wants total surrender. He wants us to be honest with Him, and He wants us to be desperate in our hearts for Him. The Bible says those that seek, those that thirst and hunger after righteousness, they shall be called. sons of God. So it means there must be a hunger in your heart. You know, God does not give, does not reveal some deep things to us when we are carrying. In Jeremiah 33:3, God said, he said, call unto me and I will show you great and mighty things. This call is not just like you calling somebody on the phone or just calling somebody and like, hey, hello, I'm here. No, it's a state of the heart. Your heart must be in a position, in a place where it's ready, it's looking up to God, it's desperate for God, it's hungry for God. When you're hungry for God, when you're hungry for the Holy Spirit, when you are like, Holy Spirit, I can't do this, you acknowledge that without him, you can't do it. Without him, you can do nothing. Just like Jesus said in John 15, he said, without me, you can do nothing. So when you come to that place of total surrender, you're like, God, I need you. The Holy Spirit will come and he will help you in your weaknesses. He will help you overcome that addiction. He will help you overcome that weakness. He will give you the strength to continue to the finish line. You will become a firebrand Christian for Jesus. Because remember what God said in Revelation chapter 3, verse 16. He said, because you're neither hot nor cold, he said, I will spit you out of my mouth. So one of the things the Holy Spirit does is when the Holy Spirit, when you yield to the Holy Spirit, he empowers you, he revives you, he rekindles the fire of God in your heart. You can never be cold. You can never be lukewarm. You'll be hot for God because God is not happy with people who are lukewarm. It's just like coffee. You know, people who love drinking coffee. I've not seen anyone who like drinking a lukewarm, like cold coffee or coffee that is just lukewarm. You want your coffee hot, you know, for coffee drinkers. So it's the same thing with God. God wants you to be all in for him. God wants you to totally surrender to him. As the word of God said, the eyes of God are running to and fro, looking for those who trust in him. And what does it mean to trust God? It means you surrender your all. You're like, God, on my own, I can't do it, but I look up to you. So it's the same way the Holy Spirit wants us to. He wants us to yield to him willingly, to surrender to him, because God is not a thief. We remember what the Bible says in John 10:10. It said, the thief cometh not but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But Jesus came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. In this story, we've now realized that Jesus, the Holy Spirit, is a gentleman. He's a person. He wants to walk with your cooperation. He doesn't want to break into your life like the devil. He doesn't want to come and steal from you. He doesn't want to compel you to do something that you're not willing. He wants your full cooperation. He wants your total surrender. So when you yield to the Holy Spirit, when you come to that place where you say, Holy Spirit, I am weak. You are strong. I need you. I need you every day in my life. I need you so bad, just like the air I breathe. Then the Holy Spirit will empower you, and every day you will live for Jesus. Your life will be on fire for him.
Amen.
Because when we look at what is happening around the world today, it's virtually impossible to live as a successful Christian or to live a successful Christian life without the Holy Spirit. It's impossible. We need the Holy Spirit. You need the Holy Spirit so bad,
just
like the air you breathe. I just want you to have this in the back of your mind.
Amen.
That you cannot do it without the Holy Spirit. I have seen the Holy Spirit at work in my life for so many years. I surrendered my life to Christ in 1997, and we're in 2018. So this almost getting to 21 years in the Lord. And the thing I always see that time, I'll look at like, God, how did I get here? Or how did I make it this far? And I come out to this conclusion. By the help of the Holy Spirit, I depend on him. There are times when I feel weak, when I feel discouraged, I run to him and sincere, I'm open to him. I say, Holy Spirit, I am weak. Holy Spirit, help my mind. Holy Spirit, my thoughts are kind of like messed up. Clean
Lord.
My mind. I've talked with a lot of young people so many times. They're like, I can't stop thinking about some kind of weird, kind of dirty things and stuff like that. Who can help you overcome those kind of negative thoughts? The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will clean your mind. The Holy Spirit will make you to desire the things of God. The Holy Spirit will put in you a hunger for God you have never had. And every day will be like a new day. That's why Jesus told his disciples in Matthew 6, when he was teaching them to pray. He said, every day, he said, ask. He said, give us this day our daily bread. So our walk with the Holy Spirit should be a daily thing. Every day, ask the Holy Spirit for empowerment. Ask the Holy Spirit to give you the strength, the bread. We know bread here symbolizes food that gives us strength for the body. So the revelation we need is like this. It's actually the bread we need. Because, you know, as our body eats food, our spirit man eats the word. And when we receive praise that word, God, that rhema word from the Holy Spirit, it empowers our spirit. It rekindles our spirit man.
Yes.
It sets our spirit man on fire.
Yes.
And we can live for Jesus. We can talk about Jesus 24/7 by the help of the Holy Spirit. So that is what the Holy Spirit can do to a life that will yield to Him.
Amen. So looking at what you're saying, I know that God wants us to be sincere with Him. Actually, Jesus came for sinners. He came to free us from sin. But we have to be sincere with Him. A lot of times we stay in our bondage because we are not sincere. Deep inside of us, we may know we are not doing right. But because of what we want to present out there, we cover. And I don't believe God wants us to cover our sins because He knows it. And He is the person that matters. You can cover to mankind, make them think you are this. And there are many ways of covering. We cover with pride. We cover with so many different kinds of, you know, attitudes. But the truth is, in front of God, we are bare. But He wants you to open your own mouth and be sincere and say, Father, this is my weakness. Work with it. And the Spirit of God will begin to work in you. In that sincerity, we see the man that God has named a man after His heart. He was sincere with God, David. He sinned and he told God, I have sinned against you, only against you have I sinned. But Father, create in me a clean heart. He knew that God would be the one to enable him. He knew that God would be the one to clean that heart. He knew that God would be the one to transform his heart. He presented himself to God broken. Father, on my own, there is nothing I can do. I'm a sinner. I am condemned if it were left to me. But Lord, I know that you are able to transform me. You are able to change my heart. You are able to create in me a clean heart that you can work with. He presented himself to God like that. And he said, do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Because he knew that that was one thing. Then he will be a dead person. Without the Spirit of God, you are dead. Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, when they ate the fruit, physically they did not die. But the Spirit of God left. So they were dead person. That was what God meant when he said they would die the day they taste of that fruit. So we have to know this and know this and stop going around as dead people thinking that we are alive because the Spirit of God is not in us. So my brother, I'm so happy with what you said. And what I really got from this is the sincerity of our hearts to present ourselves to God and say, Father, this is where I am. But Lord, this is not, I know this is not what you require of me. But Lord, change my heart that I may be able to carry you, that I may be able to carry the Spirit of God in me and be able to go through this journey of life. So I thank you so much, my brother, and I pray that everyone who is watching and listening, the Spirit of God will begin to minister to them, that you can start examining your life and presenting it to God. We are not the ones who will judge you, but God will. But we are here to tell you the truth, that let me tell you what is so lost and absent in the world today. People will not tell you the truth because they are afraid to lose you as their friends or people who support them in one way or the other. But what will it really benefit a man to gain the whole world and lose their soul? So we are here to encourage you to submit to the Holy Spirit. Let Him guide you and present a heart that God can work with. And you will realize that your journey in Him will be facilitated and we will not sit and complain. God has really been good to me and He has helped me grow spiritually because the things I used to really, it's not like I don't struggle with certain things still, but I see myself growing. I'm not where I used to be. I am a very emotional person and the truth is it was so easy to get under my skin and just make me slip into depression. So, but God has trained me He has taught me, and he has put me above. And, you know, using an eagle as a, you know, as an image that I can really relate to. When I watched a documentary on the life of an eagle doesn't really like mingle with chickens down there. They fly above. So now thinking about it, whose am I? Who am I in him? So thinking about all of that, it has helped me overcome, because now I know that I am seated above all of those things that brought me depression. And now I had to look above them and focus on what I've been called to do. Because the truth is, if you continue, even as an eagle, if you continue to mingle down here, then you realize that's not where you're supposed to be. So you will not take dominion in your own area where God has called you. But we have been called to soar. That's why God says, if you wait on him, you will soar with wings like eagles. They invest into that. The eagles invest into that. It's not just something that it just happens by chance. The eagles actually have to take their time to make sure that they maintain a lifestyle that allows them to soar high. For instance, when I watched the documentary, I learned that eagles will live for 30 years, and then the next 10 years is a period that they have to work on their broken beak, or the beak that is overbent, and their heavy wings that has cling to their skin and disable them from flying high, and also on their talons as well to pull them out. And what do they have to do? They have to go through this difficult and hard process of hitting their beak on a rock to pluck it off, and actually pulling off the feathers that were heavy so that they can have rejuvenation. And they said, if they have to go through this, then they'll be able to soar high again for another 30 years. But if they are not able to do it, then they die. So they have lost 30 years just because they were not able to sacrifice and go through the pain of revival, go through the pain of waiting on the Lord and renewing their strength to live again for 30 years. So, you know, that encouraged me that when I look at the scripture, that if you wait on the Lord, you shall renew your strength. For me to apply this, it means I have to think about the life of an eagle. I have to look at the things in my life that weigh me down and pluck them out. Even if it's hurting, even if it's painful, you have to pluck it out. I have to hit those on the rock that need to go. It has to go. And after that, I have a new life. I can soar high. And that is for everybody. It's not just for me, but I overcame. I thank God. Glory to God. Indeed, because I never went on medicine. But the grace of God, he taught me this. And it helped me. It took me out. And I always say this is a testimony, because this could actually kill me. Sometimes I used to talk to my husband and I would say, you may not understand when I tell you that this is how I feel, but honestly, this is how I feel. And Brother Peter, you know, you stood with me in prayers too. So, but I remember the day I told your wife, I overcame.
Amen.
And we celebrated. I thank God. Yes, because if it were left to, you know, my flesh and what the doctor would say, they said medically I was depressed. But then, thank God, I never took a pill, but the Holy Ghost healed me.
Hallelujah.
And my life from then, and I know till tomorrow, will never be the same. Okay. So the reason why I'm sharing this is because I know we have people right now who are in their valley, and this testimony is a weapon for them to overcome. Honestly speaking, I know the word of God is true. I know the word of God does not return void. So as we are speaking this word, I pray that whoever is listening, let it bring some transformation in your life. Any area where you are struggling with, let this lift up your spirit, that you may begin to, you know, have transformation and growth in your spiritual life. So it's not just a conversation between my brother Evangelist Peter and I, but the Holy Spirit is the third person in this conversation. And Amen. He is watching over every word that is coming forth. And he is performing that which this word is sent forth to do. So I would want us to take a look at John chapter 4. We know about the encounter of the Samaritan woman at the well with Jesus Christ. First of all, let's just take a look at the relationship that existed between the Samaritans and the Jews. We know that the Jews had looked upon the Samaritans as outcasts then. They looked at them as rebellious. They looked at them as traitors. Why? Because they had intermarried with tribes and nations that God had forbid them from getting married to. So this made the Jews who thought they were the pure, you know, like the pure Jews, not to like the Samaritans, not to even want to have anything to do with them because they saw them as defiled people. As, you know, the Samaritans, they had worshipped other gods. They had forsaken the name of God, even after he had brought them out of the land of Egypt, the house of bondage. So, but Jesus bridged the gap. When Jesus had an encounter with this lady, his disciples were not there. Provided, let's say the disciples were there, you know they would have interrupted. And said, but Jesus, how could you? You cannot. This is a Samaritan or whatever they would have said then. But Jesus did not look at it that way. And when he asked for water from this woman, we know that he came for the sick. He came for sinners. So he looked at her. He saw her needs. But guess what? He related to her. He wanted her to feel comfortable to communicate with him and to open up with him. So he was like, give me a drink. And this woman, knowing that Jesus was a Jew, she did not find it funny. She was like, but I'm a Samaritan and you are a Jew, so what in common do we have? And Jesus responded, if only you knew the gift of God and you knew who I am, then you would ask me for water and I will give you this water that you will never thirst anymore.
Amen.
So this day, as we are speaking, my brother, for those watching, those who might be caught up in their own ways, those who think they have been condemned, those who think there is no way out of what I am involved in. I remember one time I spoke with one of my friends about Christ and, you know, giving her life to Christ. And she was like, I admire and I enjoy those who have given their lives to Christ. I look at their lifestyle, I enjoy it. But I can only survive by doing what I do. Because then she was going out with a married man or something like that. And I told her, but God is able to free you. And she was concerned. She said, this is the only way I survived. I left school. I don't have a job. I have a child. The father abandoned us. And this man is the one who is footing all my bills and taking care of my child as well. So if I stop the relationship now, where do I get help from? I wish there was a way out for me. And I pray that this word from John 4 will let us know that Jesus says, come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. This woman, she never saw that at first. And that's why Jesus was even giving her a hint. If only you knew the gift of God,
Hallelujah.
And if only you knew who I am, then you will ask for water. And I will give you water that you will be living water and you will thirst no more. Same way, then when I was ministering to this woman, I had just given my life to Christ. So I didn't really know much. I would have even gone to this scripture to, you know, minister to her and tell her that it doesn't matter what your life is, just give it to him. It doesn't matter what your struggles are, give it to him. Be sincere. You will not tell him how to operate with you, but he will make a way for you. You don't know how, but he will make a way for you. Abraham took his son to sacrifice. He didn't know the outcome. Probably he just knew this was it. God has requested. God requires of him. Let me give it. But guess what? At the end of the day, the name Jehovah Jireh sprung forth. A God who provides, even when you don't see a way out. So this, as we are listening right now, I pray that it will be ministering to anyone listening, I don't know what you're going through. It might be like there is no way out. Look at the life of this woman. She had been going from one man to the other, one man to the other. Already, I think even her own community, the Samaritans, they did not want to identify with her. Because we know that. There are people in our communities that because of their lifestyle, you don't want to identify yourself with them.
Mm.
But Jesus made her an evangelist.
Hallelujah.
Jesus made this woman an evangelist. She came to fetch water for her flesh, but Jesus gave her living water, and because this living water flowed out of her system because of the grace of God upon her life, she left the pot that she had brought to look for water for her flesh. And guess what? She ran into the city and talked about the good news of Jesus. She witnessed to these people. She brought the Samaritans to Jesus, Amen. Who was a Jew. And they came. And because of what they saw and what they heard, they were able to tell the same woman that, you know what? I don't only believe because of what you said, but because of what I myself has witnessed.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
So we are all evangelists, and I pray Amen. That every one of you, it doesn't matter what your situation is, present it to him. And guess what he will do? He will take that to deliver other people.
Amen.
That will become deliverance unto others. I know that sometimes we hold so strong in what we believe in, or whatever we think is what works or does not work, but let me tell you, it doesn't matter what it is. Our God is a potter.
Amen.
Just give him the clay, he will form it. Give him even a broken pot, he will crush it and mold it again.
Hallelujah.
He is able. So I am grateful, and please don't leave. Nobody should leave. Just keep watching. It might be long, but you know, this is coming from the throne of grace, and I pray that someone will be blessed. I pray that someone's life will be transformed. I pray that someone will be led by the Spirit of God. I pray that he will lift up the burden and he will ease your journey of faith. I pray that God will touch you at the point of need, wherever you think you are breaking right now. He will mend it. I pray that you will just submit to him and let him do it in his own way. Amen. Let him do it in his own way. Don't trust in your own ways. Do not trust in your own ways. Lean not on your own understanding, but let God be your God. Let him be God. Let Jesus be the Lord of your life. Submit to him. So I would want my brother to, talk to us about one more aspect. Let me see, brother, where we are right now. Okay, so far you have blessed us. We thank God for using you this morning to bring us his word. And I just want to ask you if you can do us this favor to open your mouth with utterance from the Holy Spirit and pray over the lives of those who need Christ as their Lord and Savior. And before I let you do that, I just want to shed a bit of light, because as believers sometimes, it's difficult. Nowadays, it's difficult to know who believes and who does not.
Yes.
Even those who think they believe. I pray that we'll open our hearts and let the Holy Spirit show us where we are in our relationship with God. Let it not just be by the testimony of our mouth, but let it be by the faith in our hearts. Because the Bible tells us that if you believe in your heart and then you confess it with your mouth. So it's not about me telling you that just say this prayer with your mouth, and then if you said this prayer, I believe that you are saved. No, it's about you believing in your own heart, believing, knowing that he is Lord, saying that, yes, indeed, Father, you came to save me. Jesus came to save me. He is the Lord of my life. Knowing in your own heart. And then now you confess it with your mouth. Let the abundance of your own heart now come through your mouth. So I pray that we will open our hearts as our brother will be praying, and let the Spirit of God minister to you. And I hope you make that decision, which is the best decision of your life. So, brother, can you go ahead and pray for anyone who needs Jesus as their Lord and Savior, and anyone who thought they knew him, but they are realizing now that there is more to knowing him. So would you pray for us, brother?
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank
praise
you so
the Lord.
Much, woman of God. For this wonderful time and inviting me, you know, to be a part of this great, you know, thing God is doing. And before I pray, I just want to, you know, just to add to what my sister has been saying, just to encourage you. This life without Jesus is so useless. We see every day how people are killing themselves, committing suicide, not because they are poor, because our society has made us to believe that when you have money, they say money speaks, money will solve all our problems. That is not really true. Money can solve some of our problems, but when it comes to the issue of the soul, the heart, only the Holy Spirit can help you.
Amen. Amen.
So I would like to pray with that man, that woman, that boy, that girl who is tired of being tired. Maybe you have been in church for so many years, you have become so religious, you are so tired with the system, and you are like, God, I need something fresh. I need fresh, you know, something fresh from you today. God is speaking to you and he wants to reach you.
Amen.
Maybe you are that person, you have never had the opportunity to hear about Jesus. You know, I was so surprised one time when we went out for street evangelism, and we met a girl who was so surprised that there was a man called Jesus. When we said, do you know Jesus? She asked, is he a star in Hollywood? Here in America? Nobody has ever told her about Jesus. So I don't want us to become familiar or caught up and think that everybody must have heard about Jesus. Maybe you're that person, you're hearing Jesus, about this Jesus for your very first time. Today, Jesus wants to be your friend. He wants to be your savior. And he wants to be your Lord. And I'd just like you to bow your heads with me in prayer. And if you're sick in your body, this Jesus is also is able to heal you through the power of his spirit. Amen.
Amen.
So I would like you to repeat, just like my sister said, it's not the recitation that changes, it's the condition of your heart. Because the Bible says we believe with our heart and we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord. So I'd just like you to repeat with me. You pray this prayer with me. Then after that, I will pray for all of you who need the touch of God, who need the empowerment of the Holy Spirit in your life. So if you want to make Jesus the Lord of your life this day, I just want you to repeat this prayer with me. Say, Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
I thank you for this day.
I thank you for this day.
I have heard your word.
I have heard your word.
And I believe.
And I believe.
That you.
That you.
Are the Messiah.
Are the Messiah.
The Son of the Living God.
The Son of the Living God.
The one who gave himself on the cross for my sins.
The one who gave himself on the cross for my sins.
Today.
Today.
I invite you.
I invite you.
To be the Lord.
To be the Lord.
Of my life.
Forgive my sins. Forgive my sins.
Amen.
Amen.
I'll just pray now for the rest of the people. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I thank you, Heavenly Father. For as many who are listening or watching at this time, I pray, Holy Spirit, you will touch them. You are the helper.
Yes, Lord.
From our testimonies, we know the people have heard what you did to us, even to my sister, that the doctors medically declared her to be depressed, but you healed her, you transformed her life, you delivered her from that demon of depression. I pray for that man or woman who is depressed out there, that you would deliver them from that depression, you deliver them from sickness, you deliver them from bondage in the name of Jesus. For your word says, he who the Son of Man set free is free indeed. Father, I pray for total freedom in their body, in their soul, in their spirit, in the name of Jesus. I pray, Heavenly Father, that that excitement, that joy, that life that comes only from you and you alone, Holy Spirit, will fill their hearts this day as they open up to you. Father, Lord, I give you the glory. I cover their body, soul, spirit with the blood of Jesus. I pray that from this day you begin to give them, Heavenly Father, the purpose for their living. Open their eyes to see why they are alive in the land of the living, in a time when many are losing their life, in a time when many are dying, oh God, through gun violence, accidents, and other things. But you have been keeping them. Help them to understand the purpose for their living, Lord, that they will live for you every day of their life, and they will depend on you. Holy Spirit, we give you the glory. We thank you. Take total control in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, my brother. Thank you. Thank you. It was such a wonderful time with you. And also, I just want to invite our viewers that once every month we do have a Holy Ghost dinner. Every third Saturday of the month, we do have a Holy Ghost dinner. We come together under the weight and the heaviness of God's glory, and we just enjoy His presence. So you are invited to join us this coming Saturday, which is the 17th of March, so that we can sit in His presence and just fellowship and, you know, share ideas and be led by the Spirit of God. So it was a great time with you, my brother, and I pray that anyone who joins us or listens to this will open their hearts for God to do what He is doing. Holy Ghost, we want to thank you for this moment with us. We thank you for doing what you have done and what you are still doing. And we pray for the lives out there that they will open up and you come in. So, my brother, let us go ahead and share the grace. And even those who are just watching, join us and let's share the grace of God. So, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide in us now and forevermore.